Krista DeBoer. I'm the executive director of Kestrel Land Trust, and we are really pleased to co-host this event with Amherst College. I want to thank Ethan Klotfelter for helping us put this together, and it was actually an event that we announced to our members, and within 4 hours it was sold out, waiting list, 70 spots. So tonight the snow, I think, put a damper on a couple people's plans, but I'm glad to see you all here. And I think, you know, Amherst College is really stepping up its game in terms of environmental studies and sustainability on campus, so we're really glad to have them as a partner in the Valley and working with faculty and alumni and students on all different levels to advance land conservation, climate change research, sustainability solutions. It all fits together. So I'm really delighted to welcome David Foster as our speaker tonight. David has been personally inspiring to me over the last two decades of land conservation. He's really a leader in the movement and a visionary. As the director of Harvard Forest, which is a 4,000-acre ecological laboratory, he has pioneered a vision for New England, the Wildlands Woodlands vision, which really focuses on accelerating the pace of conservation. And that has shaped my own kind of life mission, but as I've been working with Kestrel over the last decade, that has shaped what we have been doing as well. And I would actually credit you for helping us double our pace of conservation. In fact, we tripled our pace of conservation over the last 10 years. So thank you for that inspiration. We'll hear more about that tonight. I also want to highlight a few of David's outstanding books. Many of the first one I came to know is Thoreau's Country, which is published in 1999, Forests and Time, 2004, and I was really struck, you know, being with the mammoth and the mastodon to really think about time on a different scale, and that's what David is very skilled at doing and helping conservationists think not only on a global level, but on a scale of time that will make a difference over 50, 100 years. He's also written a book about hemlocks, and his most recent book is A Meeting of Land and Sea about Martha's Vineyard, which I think we'll hear a little bit about tonight. So David has been a longtime member of Kestrel Land Trust as well, and is a Shutesbury resident, so we're lucky to have him in the Valley and very grateful for him to offer to do this for us tonight. So thank you.
Thanks. Well, thanks very much. It's absolutely great to be here. Thanks for coming out. This is one of the most dynamic and inspirational organizations, not to mention colleges, in the region. And so it's great to both be associated with Kestrel and to meet some of you and to talk about the subject of conservation kind of in the era of global change or climate change. And one way to think about that is kind of where is New England going, both as a result of conservation and as a result of climate change, and what are the relationship between those two subjects, which is what I'd like to explore. First, I'd like to just draw your attention to this map, which is one of the reasons that I focus on New England, besides the fact that I live here. New England is an important part of the United States in a couple of different ways. One, it's part of an incredible span of forest that stretches from the southern U.S. up to Canada, which, as we'll talk about, has a very unusual history that makes it actually a critical player in helping to slow the rate of climate change. But secondly, New England and adjoining New York is an essential connection between the South and the Appalachians and Canada. And so when we think about it biologically, we think of all the things that that forested and farmed landscape provides to people. And when we think it as of a connector, we see how critical it is for helping organisms deal with the future of a changing Earth. So this particular map shows the forested areas of as much of North America as I could fit onto this slide. And the different colors relate to the different composition of the forest as is reflected and observed from satellites. Just a little bit of background on me. As Kristen said, I'm the director of the Harvard Forest, which is a department of Harvard University. It's an unusual research facility because it's an actual department of university that has been placed out into north central Massachusetts with the idea that beginning in 1907 when it was founded, that it was essential if people were going to understand and work with nature, that they, these scientists and these students actually experience nature through all the seasons and all the changes that it undergoes. And to understand not just the natural system, but also to understand the culture of the people who live there and what the pressures were on the land, what the land was providing to them. And that's certainly as true today as it was when we were founded. So we do have 4,000 acres. We do a lot of teaching for undergraduates and graduate students. We also do a lot of research. It's funded by the National Science Foundation and other agencies of the federal government, foundations, and so on. If I get on the top of our building and look towards Amherst, this is what I see. A phenomenal expanse of forest that includes just a peak of the Quabbin Reservoir. Now, that figures in importantly into the incredible conservation ethic that we have, because we and many other organizations join together with Kestrel and others in conserving the land that helps to keep Quabbin what it is, keep the watershed what it is. But we also recognize that we have this incredible resource out at our fingertips that we want to conserve. If I get up in the sky and look down at our landscape, though, it's got 110 years of research ongoing in it. So essentially every single spot on that ground has been studied and is part of a long-term study. So that adds even more incentive into conserving the land around it because we want to have a laboratory which reflects the general natural and cultural landscape of north central Massachusetts. Included in that work is a tower, which this arrow is trying to point at in the middle of our forest. So I'm standing on the top of a tower that has a big platform for viewing and for education and for some studies. But it looks at a series of other towers and landscape that we study very intensively. This particular installation that it's pointing at has been measuring the amount of carbon dioxide going into and out of the forest since the late 1980s. So it's the world's largest or longest record of the exchange of carbon dioxide between the forest and the atmosphere. And what you can see is the wavy line going up is the seasonal fluctuations in this uptake and release of carbon dioxide, with uptake being in the summer, release being in the winter. But the important thing about this is that it's always going up, which means that carbon dioxide is being actively stored in this forest. And it's emblematic of what's happening all the way from the Canadian border and into Canada, all the way down through that southern landscape that I showed you the map of. And so our forest, the Harvard Forest, and our forest writ broadly, are an incredible resource for a lot of different reasons, but one of the reasons has global implications, which is that by storing carbon, we're reducing the rate at which carbon dioxide is accumulating in the atmosphere and changing the climate. So I will draw from these three resources for most of what I talk about. This book on hemlock is really trying to capture the history and importance of hemlock at a time when hemlock is suffering one of its greatest losses through time. It actually turned out that 5,000 years ago, hemlock nearly completely disappeared from the New England landscape. But this is happening at a very rapid rate today because of an invasive insect, the hemlock woolly adelgid. So we talk both about the ecology of the species and this, you know, tragedy that is befalling this species and our landscape. The book on Martha's Vineyard, I'll show a few slides of and draw some kind of observations and lessons from. We study the coast because it's such a different environment than the inland parts of New England, and we are interested in the contrasts and the similarities, and we're also interested in understanding the variety of processes and how they're changing in this rapidly changing environment. And then wildlands and woodlands, I'll talk quite a bit about. It really is this effort to conserve all of New England and to increase the rate of at conservation. So I'm not going to belabor the details of climate change, but climate change is real, and there's a lot of different ways we can document it. This is a very striking way, which shows the changes in seasonal temperature on the globe over the span from 1880 to 2016, showing that at all seasons there's a increase in temperature over time. And then many of you have read recently in the paper this great article that was published by Ray Bradley and colleagues at the University of Massachusetts, showing rather shockingly that if you look at the rate of warming in the globe and across the United States, you can see that the northeastern U.S. is the leader in terms of the rate at which climate change is occurring. And so it's going to reach this 2 degrees warming faster than any other part of the country. So climate change is real and is happening. What's it going to do to broadly to our landscapes, and especially if we look at our forested regions? What other things are changing this landscape? And what role does conservation play in helping to slow the rate of those changes and control the way that, or influence the way that nature actually deals with these changes? Before I get to that, I just want to make one thing very clear. We're able to do a lot about climate change if we have the political will, and if we have both nationally and globally partners to work with. And a great example of this, which I think doesn't get enough play, is shown here. We don't hear very much about acid rain these days. So it might have been a hoax, or something might have happened. Well, this is the way that both nitrate and sulfate, so sulfur compounds and nitrogen compounds, which are forming the acids of acid rain, looked in the 1980s. Nationally, there was a decision to try to do something about that. And that's what happened. Both declined precipitously, and they declined because of the Clean Air Act and subsequent legislation. So we don't hear enough of these kinds of stories to show the role that government at a range of different scales, but including national government and national legislation, can play in dealing with major problems. Sulfur started declining immediately, and then more was done eventually to deal with nitrogen compounds, and those are both declining. Well, that makes a huge difference, both in terms of acidity and its influence on lakes and streams and forests, but also simply in terms of nitrogen, which is a major fertilizer. All the fertilizer you spread on anything has nitrogen because it's such a limiting factor. It was essentially fertilizing all of our landscapes, and that has been brought down tremendously. So we can do a lot, but even if we don't do a lot, at a global and national scale, I would argue there's a tremendous amount we can do locally in our communities, in our backyards, and at a regional scale, and that's going to be mostly what I emphasize. So, first of all, what's climate change going to do to our forested region of New England? Interestingly, over the next 100 years, and we have a big research group that is looking at this, climate change itself will not change our forests very dramatically in terms of the species that are in them, but it will change them in terms of the way they operate biologically. So this is just comparing basically close to 100 years of change from the present to 2100 in terms of the seasonality of growth. And the green color here represents the most productive growth, so when the forests are growing the most rapidly. And then the light colors down through here represent growth, but slower growth. And the black colors represent when the leaves have fallen off of deciduous trees, it's cold, and there's relatively little growth. So basically, there's going to be quite an extension of the growing season. And the productive part of the growing season is going to move into earlier into April. So that'll be a significant impact in terms of the way that the forests operate, in terms of changes that organisms are going to have to deal with it. So there are certainly major ramifications of that. But we see in the newspaper and elsewhere a lot of caricatures of climate change and what it's going to do. The one on the left shows the fact that essentially the climate of a state like New Hampshire is going to get warmer, and so New Hampshire is effectively going to move south in terms of its climate domain. And that's actually a pretty good caricature. It is going to get warmer. We are going to be experiencing longer growing seasons, and so there is some analogy between, say, the Carolinas and the future climate of New Hampshire. The caricature that's wrong is the one on the right, which shows sugar maple, which at the top is today, is very abundant, as shown by the yellow, and then really abundant is shown by the red in there. And then in the future, say 2100, it shows almost no sugar maple in New England, most of it having moved into Canada. The reason that this is wrong is because sugar maples live 200, 300, 400 years. So sugar maple that is 100 years old that is out growing in a forest today is certainly not going to be moving to Canada. It's going to continue to grow, and in fact, it's going to grow better, and it's going to grow over a longer season. The climate that's optimal for it and the climate that's optimal for it to get established in and to keep replacing itself, that's going to move to Canada. But those trees will continue to grow. So if we do absolutely nothing to our forest, and if the trees are well established in the forest, they will continue to grow for a long time. So what could change our forests more rapidly over that time period? Well, in order to get new species into the forest, you have to kill the existing species that are there. And so there are a number of ways to do that. One is by the outbreak of an insect or a pathogen. And so this is a picture from North Carolina of hemlock trees that have died within 3 years from the hemlock woolly adelgid. In our landscape, it takes longer because it's a much colder climate. As the climate warms, hemlock woolly adelgid is going to spread farther north, and it's going to operate much more rapidly in this region. That will kill the trees, that will open up space, new species will get established, and that kind of replacement is how you get major changes in forest composition. The other thing that could happen is if, as is predicted, climate gets more variable and we have more intense rains along with more precipitation and longer droughts, it could be that the droughts are severe enough to actually kill trees, in which case you could get a substantial amount of change. And this is just a map showing the extended droughts that have occurred recently in the last few years, showing that southern New England has experienced that, and certainly Massachusetts did this past year. And so the numbers have to do with kind of rank ordering of different areas, from one being the highest and blue being the lowest. The interaction between these things might kill trees. So this is a picture from Martha's Vineyard taken in 2009. That entire ridge in the back is oak trees that all died that year or the year before. And so this was due to the combination of 3 years of outbreak of native species, a kind of caterpillar, and one exotic species, a closely related but exotic caterpillar, hitting those trees 3 years in a row and weakening them, and then a drought happening in the third year. And so across an area of about a mile, the entire forest of oak trees was killed off. Now, down here in the valley, where you see beech trees and red maples and some oaks, it was moister and they didn't die. So, unusual circumstances of weather, outbreaks of insects, those can kill trees and change the forest very rapidly. The surviving trees in that forest, the ones that are green up there in the gray, are beech trees which weren't affected by this insect and so survived through this. If you go into that forest today, there's both essentially a bad news and a good news story here. So this is a forest in which all the overstory trees have died. And so on the one hand, that's a tragedy for that forest. But on the other hand, if you look down close to the ground, there's a complete layer of saplings that now reach up about 15 or 20 feet. I was out to this site last weekend, that have all regenerated and are growing back. So it's a functioning forest. It's a perfectly intact functioning forest, despite the fact that all the overstory trees have died. The reason that it's a functioning forest is because in its expansive, intact area, it's not broken up by roads and houses and other kinds of interruptions. And it hasn't been terribly disturbed by other factors, and so all the trees are regenerating. Now, it turns out that beech is regenerating even better than oak, and so that forest is going to nudge towards a beech composition. So that's the opportunity for change. So if we look, I'm a paleoecologist as well as an ecologist. I study, as Kristen said, forests and landscape back in time. If we look in this region, and this is Little Pond, if you look at the top, there's a pollen diagram from Little Pond in Royalston, northernmost Massachusetts, just north of here. And you can see that 6,000 to 5,000 years ago, hemlock declined from being the most abundant tree in that landscape to almost nothing. And that was the combination of climate change, drought, and perhaps some kind of biological agent like a pest or a pathogen. And this shows the change in hemlock from before to the middle of that low period for all these other different sites. So we've seen that kind of thing in the past, which means that climate change, not just the magnitude of the temperature, but the other kinds of disturbances that occur with it, can have a big impact and can lead to rapid changes. Now, in terms of our current situation with hemlock, the one thing we can take heart in is the fact that hemlock did recover and become dominant again. So that may bode well for hemlock in the future. The unfortunate thing is it took about 1,000 years. The way that we manage our forests makes a big difference. And so you can, when you go in and you cut trees, you select which trees you're going to cut and how intensively you're going to cut and where you're going to cut. And what this suggests is that we need to cut very thoughtfully, because yes, we do need resources, but every time we cut our forest, we provide an opportunity for that forest to change. And so sometimes we want to change it in particular directions and we can accomplish that. Sometimes if we don't think about it, we can change forests in ways that we don't necessarily want to encourage. So managing in forests, killing trees, opening forests up, that's the opportunity for change, which can be either positive or negative. One of the things that we certainly can prevent, and one of the things that is probably the most harming to forests and to farmland is the conversion of those to something else. And these are two of the common examples that you see in the New England landscape. When we decide to convert a agricultural field to something else, in this particular case it's a solar array, in other cases it might be houses or roads or parking lots, or when we take a forest and we start perforating it and breaking it up, fragmenting it in a variety of ways. And so out of this comes the notion that we can individually and as communities and as a state do an awful lot about how our landscape changes just by being mindful of what we actually do in the land today. And that's something that's very controllable, and it's something which actually figures into climate change, because every time we whittle away our forests in this way, we're reducing that area that's storing carbon, and so we're reducing our ability to mitigate climate change. We're also breaking the forests up and introducing lots of other activities and species into the forest in ways that make it a lot less easy for those forests to recover and to regenerate after we have disturbances, whether they're ones that we generate by cutting the trees or they're ones that happen due to natural disturbances or the introduction of other organisms or whatever. So let me put some of this into some context. This is a graph which shows the changes in forest cover that have occurred in New England since the time of European settlement. At that point, New England was essentially a completely forested landscape. Over time, over the next couple hundred years, New England was substantially deforested and converted to agricultural land because people spreading all across New England were subsisting off of resources that they were getting from their own backyards or their own communities. And so as the population grew, the amount of forest cover declined as agriculture grew to feed that population. In the mid-19th century, coincident with the expansion of the United States, the Industrial Revolution, and increased transportation from canals and railroads out to the West and Midwest, you get a shift in agriculture westward, a reduction in agriculture here, people walking away from their land, and in some cases their houses, and forests coming back naturally. And so there's this incredible increase in forest in every one of the New England states at the same time that the population is increasing more rapidly than ever. And of course, at that point, people are importing a lot of resources from other parts of the United States and gradually to the other parts of the world, and living in a more industrialized society and more concentrated populations in New England. And all of that increased until about 20 years ago, when for the first time, each of the New England states gradually started seeing a deforestation. A deforestation. In this case, it wasn't for agriculture. It was for residential housing, commercial buildings, parking lots, and roads. And so instead of converting to fields, which could easily regenerate back into forests, we've converted to kind of hard surfaces that regenerate much more slowly or may never regenerate. So out of this comes the fact that essentially inadvertently, New England redeveloped an incredible forested resource. And this slide, to me, argues that we, in a sense, have a second chance to decide the fate of our forest. And the first time we converted it to agriculture, now we're converting it to something else, and we can stop. So when we did all that, we came back with a forest, but the main point of these two is to show that if you look at the forest that was here when European settlement occurred, it had lots more chestnut and oak in the south, hemlock and beech in the north, and now we've come back and we have a subtly different forest. We have less of those species and more red maple, basically. The interesting thing about this forest is this forest in our landscape today is still changing very rapidly because it's growing. Each of the trees is getting older, the forests are getting more massive, they're maturing, and that will continue for a couple of centuries. If we just sit back and do nothing, the New England landscape will change slowly just because of the growth and slow changes in that forest. So the question is, if we're going to do something about our forests, if we're going to protect our forests, if we're going to manage them that better, how do we do that? And this is where it comes down to what individuals and communities and states and eventually the region can do. Because if you look at New England, the vast majority of it is this green color, which is that top family forest, private individuals, families, and in some cases, entities like nonprofit organizations that own land, 60% of New England. And the big block in the blocks in the north, which are a different color, are corporate ownership, various kinds of investment firms and so on that own northern Maine. But most of New England is going to be decided by the actions of individuals and families to conserve their land, to develop their land, to manage it one way or another. And that's where we as individuals come into play, and that's where organizations like land trusts come into play, working with individuals. So I won't go into this in detail because there are wonderful publications produced by UMass that talk all about how an individual might manage their forest if they're worried about the way that it is going to change with climate change, or it's going to survive effectively with climate change. I love this triangle, this pyramid produced by Dave Kittredge, who's a professor at the University of Massachusetts. He says the foundation of every landowner's ethics should be to protect the forest. The next thing is, when you start thinking about landscapes, do no harm. Understand it so that you manage it effectively and well. Think at a landscape scale. In other words, think beyond your own property and how it's connected to other properties and how they might be managed and treated in concert or in ways that play off of each other. Manage is informed by history. In other words, understanding what has changed your forest before, understanding how it's gotten to be where it is and how rapidly it's growing will tell you a lot about where it's going to be in the future. And then always, after you've done something, come back and think hard about what you've accomplished and whether it's what you intended to accomplish. So evaluate before you go back and do more. Looking at this historical curve, which we as ecologists and some of us as kind of environmental historians have put together and witnessed change even over our lifetime. A group of us got together in 2005 as academics to say, you know, we've studied this land so much, we've documented all these changes, we can see where it's heading if we don't do more to conserve it. We should make a statement, perhaps even a very bold statement, about what New England, or in this case, what Massachusetts could do with its land going forward in terms of conservation. If we, in a very concerted way, with all the land trusts and all the state agencies and all the private individuals who are interested in conservation, looked at our land, what could we actually accomplish? And then in 2010, we expanded that to a New England-wide scale, which then got some other groups interested in saying, well, if you're looking at forests, let us look at farmland and think of what can be done in terms of both conserving farmland and growing our own food. So starting to think of New England as an integrated landscape of forests and farms and communities, and thinking about the future both in terms of keeping it intact but also producing resources for ourselves, food and wood and other resources, that would help to motivate a larger group of people to become involved in this conservation effort. And so we came up with this figure for all of New England. And it kind of encapsulates what we have. Let me see if I can, oops. Well, if you look at here, that's the amount of forest that we have in New England today. It's almost 80% forested. We've got about 7% farmland, 9% developed land, 5% water and wetlands. We said that realistically, even if development occurs at the rate that it has been, and kind of the conversion of forests and farmland to hard surfaces occur, that over the next 50 to 60 years, we could actually go from about 20% or a little bit more conserved forest in New England to about 70% of New England in conserved forest. And we could conserve all of our farmland and we'd have between 7%, which we have today, or if this New England food vision, which envisions growing more food in New England, comes about, we could actually increase that by converting some of the more recently converted forests back into farms. And so the Wildlands and Woodlands vision is all about increasing the pace of conservation to achieve a permanent land base of protected forests and farmland. And at the same time, it envisions what people would call smart development, growing our developed landscape in a more efficient and effective way by redeveloping spaces, by using land more effectively, and by strategically placing that development so it doesn't impinge on these forests and these farmlands. The argument for doing all of this is all the benefits that we and nature get from that combination of forests and farmland. The resources, the enjoyment, the diverse organisms, the functioning of streams and of forests that provide us with water, provide us with climate mitigation, provide us with the joy of living in New England. So the question is, where do we stand in all of this? Is this a reasonable goal? And how are Kristen and the rest of the world doing to achieve this goal? And if you go back here, the interesting thing is that there's been a noticeable increase in the rate of conservation. And so this line, which used to look and certainly would look a lot steeper if we put it back here, is actually not as much of an increase as one might expect. So the challenge is that 24,000 acres of land are being developed in New England every year. The downturn in the economy slowed that immensely. And now it's starting to pick up again. So that's one challenge. The other challenge is, despite all of our great efforts to increase funding from state sources and federal sources and private sources, that if you look at the top here, the overall funding from public entities, federal and state entities, has been going down since about 2008, so coincident with or starting a little bit before the downturn in the economy. So we're well below where we were at a peak. And there's great variation by state. Now, if you look at totals of the amount of money that is coming from both state and federal sources, Massachusetts is phenomenally successful, getting a tremendous amount relative to the other states of state funding. So a real success story. And interestingly, some states, like the Live Free and Die state of New Hampshire, really does most of its conservation with federal funding and with private funding. If you look at it a different way, though, in terms of per capita state funding, just by state funding by itself, Vermont's the big leader And Massachusetts is doing well, but doesn't stand out the way it did overall. So one effort that we are working on, and I should say that when I talk about we, I'm talking about working with this group of authors from Wildlands and Woodlands, which is a group of academics, and working with an organization that Bill Labick works for, which is called Highstead Foundation. We're trying to find various ways to help land trusts and help the larger conservation community address this issue. And one of the ways is trying to increase public funding from municipalities, states, and federal funding. And of course, Massachusetts is a big leader with the CPA and other sources of funding that come from local decision making along with state decisions. Where do we stand in terms of conservation? So going towards 10 million acres conserved in New England, and this shows the spread of that between public and private land. The graph at the right shows the amount of forest land that's conserved by individual states relative to the amount of forest that is in that state. So the gray bar represents the percentage of the state that's forested, and the green bar represent the amount that's currently conserved. The dark gray bar represents what would need to be accomplished to reach this goal that we've stated. The fantastic thing is that across New England, half of the total conservation that's occurred has occurred in the last 25 years. So this uptick in the rate of conservation is really incredible, and it represents a huge change from the preceding time. A lot of that has occurred in the north in these great big blocks, and 73% of that has occurred because of conservation easements. So this ability to conserve land and allow private landowners to still own the land and live on it and manage it has been an incredibly effective tool. So there's quite a lot of success to go with and to try to combat a lot of the threats.
Could you just go back to that one?
Sure.
It looks kind of like Massachusetts there is even more closely speckled than the other ones that are below it that are speckled. And that looks like public land. All those little spots, is there something special going on in Massachusetts versus the other states?
Well, of course there's something special going on in Massachusetts. If you look at Massachusetts on the bar graph, Massachusetts is the closest to reaching kind of this goal and to have conserved the largest percentage of its forest. So Massachusetts is certainly at the leading edge of land conservation. What's striking, even more so picking up on the patterns that you talked about, though, if you put adjoining New York next to this, the patterns are completely different. There isn't all that fine speckling. That fine speckling is all the actions of this tremendous array of local land trusts we have working with individual landowners. And that is the hallmark of New England is the density of land trusts and the effectiveness of those land trusts to connect with local landowners, individual landowners. Massachusetts also does have a lot of state land relative to others. So how do we increase this pace of conservation even more? Well, one of the things that this Highstead Foundation, in particular Bill Labick, has been working on is to try to work with collections of land trusts, municipal boards, state agencies, and other organizations with individual regions that they are collectively interested in. And so to bring together into collaboration partnerships, which are called regional conservation partnerships, which are collaboratives to increase the pace of conservation by making it more effective, by being able to work across broader scales and on larger projects that can attract more funding, and to collectively reach more landowners and to help them make decisions about conserving their land. And Kestrel is very active in at least two of these regional conservation partnerships. And so not only doing work individually as its own organization with landowners, but partnering with many others. There are now 43 or so of these partnerships across 60%+ of New England. And so this is a way to make those individual organizations kind of doubly effective, because they can not only work on their own, but they can work in collaboratives. And just to give an example of that, we at the Harvard Forest have been working very actively with this North Quabbin Regional Landscape Partnership. And you can see the effectiveness of that group of organizations. Everything in green was conserved land in 1990. Everything in blue has been added since then up till 2010. This map is out of date, and there'd be even quite a bit more. But that North Quabbin Regional Landscape Partnership is, you know, 26 towns. There are 22 active partner organizations or entities that reach together. They do a lot of landowner outreach. They do a lot of effective fundraising for large sums of money, a lot of federal funds and all, to do multiple parcel projects that really conserve a lot of land at a given time. And to bore in on that even more, this is the picture of Petersham, Massachusetts, where we started in 1993 with all this land in gray. We identified everything that's in purple and in green as a priority. Everything that's in green has been conserved. The purple remains to be conserved, but just this last year, everything that has been circled was conserved. And the Harvard Forest is shown here, the four main blocks. The blue is all the old land. The red is all the new land that we have purchased. And the shading, or the hashing going across it, is all the land that we've put under conservation easements. And my goal is, by the time that I retire, to have all of the Harvard Forest legally conserved. And that adds then to this larger whole. It also connects a lot of the existing conservation land together. It works for us because it protects our boundaries and all of our science, and it works for the larger conservation effort. Another way that we're trying to increase the rate of conservation is to reaching out to colleges and universities across the region. As we all know, New England has one of the densest concentrations of universities and colleges, ranging from really small private ones to really big, larger private ones and really large public ones. And this is just a sampling of the organizations that are currently involved. I've got a note up there that says there are 24 that we haven't added yet to this map. But the idea is that at colleges, you've got four constituencies you can work with. You can work with administrations to conserve the land that the college owns, or to help the local community conserve land. And there's some great examples of that. And there's some leadership in organizations like Middlebury that have recently done a big conservation organization. We're trying to be a leader at the Harvard Forest. There are many other examples. So that's one way. The other is that faculty can get very actively involved doing research, being on boards, and so on, that can help the conservation organizations advance their efforts, as can students working as interns. And there's some growing programs to facilitate that. And then there's an alumni base. And when I do a lot of speaking to alumni groups at Harvard, and usually I tell them about our science, and I tell them about our undergraduate education programs. And they love to hear about our undergraduate education programs more than they like to hear about our science. But what really has started to get them excited is when I get up and I start talking about our work conserving the New England landscape. Because for those people, many of whom are very strongly conservation-minded themselves, when they think that their university is both conserving its own land and trying to help New England in a major conservation effort, they're incredibly motivated. because they think of Harvard as being something that's only working on kind of global scale politics and carbon issues and environmental issues. But to think it's actually working in its own backyard is incredibly motivating. So there's a group of alums who can be helped to conserve their own land. And what we tend to do is to point them in the direction of land trusts that they can work with, or who can contribute to efforts that we're involved in, or can help to work with other efforts elsewhere. So as I pull to a close, I just want to mention a couple of other things. This is why you want to start early and work hard. This is Martha's Vineyard. Everything that's in this greenish color is conserved land. All these little dots are buildings. Martha's Vineyard is 40% conserved, which is remarkable. It has a land bank. It has very active land conservation going on in spite of the phenomenal price of land out there. But this illustrates that the reason you start early is because before you know it, conservation becomes a major defining factor in your landscape. When you first start out, a conserved land piece of land doesn't look any different than the adjoining land. But over time, as development starts crowding in around conserved land, you can define conservation by the exclusion of that development. And if you don't start early, as Martha's Vineyard happened to do, and don't move very quickly, it will get way ahead of you. So you want to keep doing what you're doing. And that brings me to this point, which is thinking of what Kristen asked me to talk about, which was the role of conservation in an era of climate change. I was trying to think of a way of summing things up, and then I went on the Kestrel webpage. And I saw this at the top of this slide. You can do something powerful today to address the greatest challenge our planet faces. Conserve the forests you love. So what you do, what we as individuals do, what we as a town or a community or a collection of town and communities do, brings great satisfaction to us, makes immeasurable difference in our own backyard, but it also is one way that we can have a measurable impact on the fate of our globe. And if we do that collectively, it can magnify to the point that it makes a big difference. And the success of this organization is a phenomenal example of that. So in the end, even though we feel helpless in the face of these kinds of pressures and these kinds of changes, the decisions that we make over, you know, kitchen tables, the conversations we have with our neighbors to help them conserve land, the effort of individuals who step up and really do a lot to conserve landscape and communities they like, and our ability to reach out to kids and bring on the next generation of folks like that will allow us to continue to have these beautiful landscapes and to continue to derive great food and good products from them, as well as an enjoyable and healthy life. So thank you very much.
Thank you, David. I think we have some time for questions, and I want to make sure Ethan can comment a bit about Amherst College where all is, if you'd like to. I want to make sure that.
Sorry, to comment in well, role is what?
How is Amherst College engaged in conservation? What do you see for your students? Are they interested in this as an angle in the greater environmental world, for example?
Well, I think our students are sort of just now, we have a new office of sustainability, and our students are really interested in sort of figuring out their connection to the how their daily lives affect global issues, and so I think they're finding out ways to sort of understand the impact that they have and how to change that. I think they're they're coming from all parts of the country, so they don't necessarily come with a particular regional focus. They are interested in maybe their issues that are close to their home state, their home country, so there really is kind of a global focus there. I don't know if other people in our department want to comment as well.
I can comment super quickly. I'm Kate Sims, and I'm here teaching economics and environmental studies, and I've seen tremendous interest by students in land conservation topics. I've actually been teaching it in econometrics, which is kind of fun to bring those land conservation questions in. And I think we see ourselves as just trying to develop tools and skills for the students so that they can go out and do this kind of work from various different angles, you know, from sociology, from anthropology, from biology, et cetera. And I guess I had a question for you along those fronts,
sure.
Along that front, which is, since we do a lot of research, what do you see as the biggest research questions that are more on the social science front? This is a question reflecting my bias, having worked on the tensions between land conservation and human development, mostly in other parts of the world. What do you see in terms of questions addressing those tensions in New England? What are good research questions for the future that maybe our students could work on?
So we're not social scientists, but we do work with a number of social scientists, and we work with people who are trying to understand what motivates people to make particular kinds of decisions. So one big body of research is what does motivate private landowners? You know, what are the forces that lead them to make decisions in one direction or another? What kind of information can they use? How do they react, or would they react, in the face of particular types of challenges? And of course, what emerges from that is also very important is, how do you reach private landowners? How do you reach individuals? And not surprisingly, as we're seeing in the world today, you reach them through their social networks. You reach them through their peers, through their relatives, through the people that they hang out with. And so that very much changes the way that you try to do the kind of work that a land trust does. You know, you don't just do kind of blanket mailings of people. You try to train and encourage local kind of thought leaders and community networked people to become allies in sharing that. So there's a whole body of research about that. There's a whole nother body of research that just deals with what are the positive visions that people have. We're doing a lot of scenario work. And so one of the things we're trying to do, looking out 50 or 100 years, is what's going to actually drive the future of our landscape? Well, it's going to be climate change, and it's going to be the actions of people. And so once you have an understanding of the way that different scenarios might emerge, a conservation scenario versus a high-cost energy or development scenario, we can then try to use those to model either socially or ecologically what that does to the landscape. So there's all kinds of facets to the kind of conservation action and management action that make a big difference. Other questions? Yeah.
I wondered if you had any involvement in the new bill for the State House introduced 11 days ago for making Massachusetts 100% reliant on renewable energy by 2050. If you've got any involvement or thoughts about that?
Couldn't hear the question. Then
there's a bill before.
I mean, I don't have any direct involvement in that, and so I don't really have much to offer except for, you know, the careful thinking that needs to go into what that actually means in terms of on-the-ground action and what some of the unintended consequences of that might be. One of the obvious unintended consequences was that solar array in the middle of the field, and there's a big effort now, of course, to change that. The incentives so that it doesn't lead people to just put solar arrays wherever it's easiest, but where it makes the most sense. That was not anticipated. right? The fact that people would clear-cut forests to, you know, clear-cut four or five times as much forest as the area that is actually occupied by a solar array, or that they would take prime farmland and put a solar. So that would be my biggest concern. It's the same concern that you have about using wood as a source of energy. Well, wood can be a very effective way to heat buildings. It's a pretty inefficient way to drive major power plants. And the consequences of that are, of those two alternatives, are very different. So going to renewable energy can have its downsides as well as its upsides.
Are there some references you're making there to regulations about the siting of solar arrays?
Yes, there's a movement among all the policy groups and within the state to change those regulations so that they don't provide incentives for things that go into natural systems or into food generating systems. Yeah. Sir?
I have a question about one of your earlier slides where you're talking about the carbon sequestration by the forest.
Yeah.
Is that primarily the actual forest, the foliage, or is that also due to the soil carbon sequestration as well?
Yeah, I just before this talk, I took a second line off of there because it's both. It's both the fact that you're putting more wood onto the trees, and so the trees themselves are storing more and more carbon, and then you're incorporating more carbon into the soil. And one of the reasons there's a big opportunity to incorporate more carbon into New England soils, both agricultural soils and forest soils, is because all the land use that has been undergone in the last couple hundred centuries has depleted the soil and the carbon. And so it's a combination of those. And that other line showed the amount that was going into wood, and then the one I showed is just the total.
So is there a faster rate then going into the soil in New England due to the depletion of it over the past couple hundred years, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, because if you took an old growth forest and you clear cut it and then just allowed it to grow back, it already has pretty much maximized the amount of carbon that can be in the soil. There will be some depletion, but not very much, through the process of clear cutting it, and you'll have to restore that. But these forests in New England, about half of our forests were completely cleared and turned into agricultural sites. So they lost a tremendous amount of carbon. And then the agricultural sites have been worked very heavily. But even the sites that have been cut repeatedly have depleted in carbon. So there's a great opportunity to do that, more so than in kind of pristine areas that you go into. Yeah. Yeah.
There was an op-ed in the New York Times saying that we should not march on Washington for the science rally that's taking place in March because it politicizes science and it could backfire. So I wondered what you thought about that. And also wondered how vulnerable you are to the National Science Foundation's funding and what's likely to happen over these next 4 years, if you could predict.
So, boy, who wants to predict about the current? I mean, to kind of make a point of that little comment, when you're dealing with somebody who doesn't himself know what he's going to do, how could you ever predict what he's going to do? But so let me try to look at those a little bit. Interestingly, when we generated this Wildlands and Woodlands paper, we've had two versions so far, and we're working on a third one now. We've sent it out to about between 100 and 200 people around New England and around the country, a few of whom, maybe 10% or so, who are scientists, to ask them to check the science, to think about it. There, we sent it to conservation groups, we sent it to agencies and everybody else, because we want to get a lot of feedback on this. The only group that as a whole pushed back on what we were doing were the scientists, because they said, you're moving into a different realm. you're not just publishing your science papers as you've always done, you know, through peer-reviewed journals and so on. You're actually now laying out a vision for a region which is advocacy. And that's moving from the objective science that you're doing. And so we had a meeting when we got this feedback in. We had a meeting of all of our authors, 12 of us sitting around the table, and we were dealing with various things. I said, now what are we going to do with this issue? And we thought about it for about 35 seconds. And we said, we have to stand up and say something. So that's not the same as marching on DC these days. And I didn't fully, I saw and read kind of quickly that op-ed, so I don't know all the arguments, but the general argument that you really are going to be just seeing like you are another set of political actors as opposed to scientists just squarely looking at your work and keeping at your work. I think it depends very much on what your message is, because the reason to protest is because you do want people to respect and value and use things that are true, things that have emerged from the scientific method, or things that completely jeopardize your ability to be independent and to continue to do your science. And so the things that infringe on those are worth making a statement about. Whether that leads to a mass movement and whether that could be a coordinated message coming out of that is another question. Funding is all in jeopardy. I think there's huge uncertainties. We finished the paperwork on a project in a split second the other day so that we could be assured of getting EPA funding on a grant. We did the same thing on a NASA grant because the rumor was going on that the same thing was going to happen to NASA funding. We're working with a colleague from Oregon State who's working very closely with a group of USDA scientists. They just switched the authorship on a paper so that the USDA scientist wasn't the lead author, because they now have to go through an extra set of reviews before their papers can be released. So it really is changing things. Yeah, Michael.
There was a grant or a statement you made about an increase, I believe, in easements over the last 25 years.
Yeah.
Is that right in Massachusetts? Yeah. You saw this?
That was actually the figure for all of New England, but
for
yes.
All of New England.
Yeah.
And maybe this gets back to the other question about social sciences, but what do you attribute that increase to? That was significant.
Well, so there has been, I mean, there was legislation that created the opportunity to have easements. They've been shown to be a very effective way and a less expensive way of advancing conservation, and they very much appeal to a general sense that it's wonderful to have private ownership. It's wonderful to have private owners still involved in, for example, paying taxes on their land as opposed to having it go solely to nonprofit organizations or to state entities. So there are a lot of social advantages to that as well as economic advantages. And beyond that, I guess I'd ask Kristen to explain why that has happened here.
Just one follow-up on that. So if there was a political decision made, some legislation changed, is that something that you would see continuing, or is that a controversial kind of legislation?
It's not, well.
To make those tax codes change in order to achieve that?
I mean, there's a lot that can be done to the tax code to increase it because of the way that you can, for example, deal with the donations that come from easements, and there's been efforts in Massachusetts and more broadly to deal with that. Easements were challenged a number of years ago because there are various ways of using easements, and there's a concern about this today. Using easements is a way for private individuals to get unfair advantages, unfair kind of financial advantages, or members of organizations to use easements that come through their organization. But the Land Trust organization, and especially the Land Trust Alliance, has been really vigilant in trying to professionalize everything in ways that are very transparent and very rigorous. So they seem to be on very good footing right now. The interesting anecdote that I was explaining to the group that we were working with today, that Bill was involved in, is that the most recent Vermont Land Trust data that I had gotten showed that they have actually conserved more land through donated easements than they have through easements that they paid for. So easements are also an effective way for people to be effectively give kind of a gift of conservation to the world while still while still generating some advantage to themselves through the tax laws.
Mm-hmm.
Sir?
I thought I'd draw you back, maybe to put your educator and scientist hat back on for a minute. Comment about how public policy affects your work. I'm wondering, there's something I might call a Galileo moment, which 400 years ago, culturally people thought the sun orbited the earth, and all sorts of things that made us very human-centric, geocentric, and we've evolved from that. Culturally, we don't, very few of us think of the world that way. In terms of stewardship of the earth or the environmental policy, the U.S. seems to be somewhat pre-Galileo, large parts of it at least. I'm just wondering, how do we, scientists and people who are active, how would you see going about maybe either encouraging, fomenting another Galileo moment? I think that's in the offing, or will it be 400 years, maybe 300 million years too late?
Yeah. Well, I mean, one of the ways I think about this in terms of the current world that we live in is that we're in a fortunate position here in New England because the way to proceed with a lot of activities that can operate independent or not independent of but operate well within the current kind of federal situation is to work at a regional scale where you can have local communities that are supportive, you can have local states that are, you can have individual states that are supportive, and in New England there now is a good environment for that. So there's every reason that if we want to move into a different mindset that as a nation that individual regions or parts of regions shouldn't be leaders in the example for that. So that's not a direct answer, but it's an avenue and a path that we can go on. There's a lot of science that we can bring to this. There's a lot of reality that we can bring to this. One of the really interesting thing responses I usually get when I show kind of conserving all this land and showing development going out here is I'll get a response from people who will say, well, if you conserve all that land, where will we live? Well, the reality is that there are objective limits. And the best way to deal with those limits is to act when you still have lots of choices and when you can define what those limits are for yourself rather than being forced up against them. And, just about 12 years ago, I was working with my daughter who was working on a project about NASA. And so she said, oh, look, I'm looking at the NASA webpage, and I'm finding this, and I'm finding that. I was interested in seeing what the NASA project was. They used to have a program called Mission to Planet Earth, which was all about putting satellites up so you could understand the Earth, because it was the most important planet we were dealing with. And at that point, NASA had a little phrase at the top that talked all about how important it was to look at extraterrestrial life and other planets so that we would have a place to live when the Earth reached a point where we had either run out of space or it was uninhabitable. If you think of what that actually means, how could we possibly, what technology could we bring to bear to live on another planet that we couldn't bring to bear to live on our own planet? It's absolutely extraordinary, but I'm sympathetic to the pre-Galilean analogy. Okay, sir.
Do you see any hope for New England's hemlocks introducing some kind of a woolly adelgid predator, for instance, or something like that?
I'm always hopeful, but none of those have shown to be effective at anything that will yield to the scale that is required. Now, it turned out that some of the things that were introduced for to deal with gypsy moth took a long time to take effect. But I guess right now, the only thing that is really slowing things is the climate. And the climate right now is heading in the wrong direction to be effective for very long. So, yeah.
This Alpine group you were mentioning, is that an acronym?
Yes. It stands for Academics for Land Protection in New England. And there is a Wildlands and Woodlands website, and there is a page on there for Alpine, and that's, since it's a relatively new and growing enterprise, that's going to change very much. The representative for Alpine is sitting back there in the white sweater. So if you'd like to know more, you should actually speak with her. It's based at the Lincoln Institute of Land Policy in Cambridge, but it works very closely with Wildlands and Woodlands. Yes?
I've heard there's a movement towards establishing another national park somewhere in the Quabbin area of Belchertown. Is that, do you know anything about it? Is that?
Yeah, there's been for probably 15 years.
Oh.
There's been an effort, and it's building and growing, and at the end of this I'll just ask Bill if he's got any more information. But the idea was that Massachusetts doesn't have a national forest, and that there might be a way for the state of Massachusetts to work with the Forest Service to identify an area that could become a new kind of national forest. And so the idea would be that this would be a collection of lands that wouldn't all be owned outright by the federal government, but it would be a collection of lands that would include some federal land, some state land, and some private land that was conserved with easements. And there's been a lot of interest over time, and it's just has to be a gradual process because you want to work in an open and engaging way with the communities so that they don't get the sense that something like other things have been kind of shoved onto local communities by outside forces, state or federal. Anything more to add to that, Bill?
Yeah, I'm not sure if I've heard of a national park for the Quabbin, but there is a national forest, a new model national forest. It's in western Franklin County and northern Berkshire County. There's a Mohawk Forest Partnership made up of the Franklin Regional Council of Governments, the Berkshire Planning Commission, Mass DCR, and others. And they're looking at working with the U.S. Forest Service to develop a new model for a national forest that is based on easements. So the land remains in private ownership, it's protected with a forest a conservation easement or restriction, and that's basically how they hope to develop a national forest, a privately owned, federally held easement.
And the U.S. Forest Service is already actively involved in conservation easements in Massachusetts. And so this is just a different model with more direct involvement of the Forest Service.
Representative Kulik is going to introduce legislation for that this session. They're trying to move that.
And are these so-called working forests?
Right.
Ones like agricultural ones, but it's forests.
So actually, maybe that's one question I have, is if you could comment a little bit on the wildlands part of the wildlands vision and why that was incorporated as part of the conceived notions.
the origins of wildlands and woodlands actually started with wildlands, and they were partly spurred by conversations I'd had with you and others, which was there is this thought that, well, since so much of New England has experienced very heavy land use in the past, does it make sense to actually think about setting aside big, effectively wilderness areas when, of course, it's wilderness areas with a cultural history? And our argument has always been, well, yes. I mean, we've got fabulous wilderness areas in, you know, the White Mountain National Forest, for example, which are areas that were very heavily logged and so on. As we sat down to make an argument for talking about establishing these wildlands, we recognized that, well, wildlands in and of themselves are not sufficient. You need to embed those in an expanse of woodlands. And since most of the land is owned by individuals, since there's a need to develop resources, we really want to have the majority of land available for that kind of management, a variety of different kinds of management. But it still made sense to try to create entire landscapes, expansive areas, where you could have natural processes operate in conjunction with whatever the prevailing climate is, but without direct human interference. And so that's the wildlands component. And if you look at that graph closely, I didn't draw attention to it, in that 70% of New England that's conserved, 10% of that area is thought of as wildlands, or could be. We're thinking that's a reasonable target. We currently have in New England something on the order of 1%. So this would be a great expansion of the amount of wildlands. And they serve a variety of purposes. They provide a very different type of habitat and landscape to support nature. For humans, they provide a number of things, a control, an example of what land looks like when it's not managed. So you can contrast that against all the land that we do manage so that you can judge what we're actually doing to the land. And actually, the Wilderness Society and other organizations focused on preserving nature intact were motivated early on by people, by the need and the desire of people to go into places where they weren't surrounded by lots of evidence and lots of noise and activity of people actively working the land. And so there's a number of human benefits in addition to natural benefits. And we still argue for that. And New England has some of the greatest opportunity to create new wilderness areas, like the new national monument that was designated up north recently by President Obama, in northern New England, because there are big expanses that are undeveloped and possible to let go well.
Thank you. Well, I think we should probably wrap up and let everyone get home. I really appreciate the conversation and you all coming out. And if you'd like to be more involved with Kestrel Trust, please give me a ring. And I appreciate your support to date. Thank you so much, David.
Thank you. Thank you.